Okay, this is the second in a sequence of presentations where we look at ingredients relative to severe storm forecasting. In this one, we will focus on the source and evolution of lapse rates, which are part of what helped generate the instability that supports severe thunderstorm development. Okay, lapse rates. When we talk about lapse rates, at least in the central United States, we're primarily referring to what we call as the elevated mix layer. And this starts with strong daytime heating and mixing, except it's over the high terrain of the western and southwestern United States, so the plateau. Most of the elevations out there are anywhere from 5 to 10,000 feet above sea level. So the heating and mixing there, when you transfer that air over the lower elevations to the east, we can set up an interesting structure in the vertical, which favors severe storm development. So we've got, just like everywhere else, it's surface heating and mixing. We drive a mix layer. It tends to be dry over the plateau, especially in the spring and early summer before the monsoonal moisture situation sets in. And so what we're really looking at is, just like in the moist layer, within that, we're considering the depth of the mix layer. It's how warm is it at the surface, and what does the rest of the temperature profile look like? And we can get different combinations or depths of the mix layer depending on that whole vertical structure of the profile. So I'll show you what it looks like climatologically out there and how that applies to soundings. Okay, so here's Albuquerque. This is the evening before the infamous May 3rd, 99 tornado outbreak in Oklahoma and Kansas. We see a typical surface-based mix layer that extends from about 550 millibars down to the surface, so nice deep surface mixing. Notice it's nearly dry adiabatic. And this is just a deep surface-based mix layer. The sun's out, and this is pretty typical over the high terrain, because you notice Albuquerque's surface elevation, the pressure is lower than 850 millibars. So it's several thousand feet above sea level to start with. Now we look at Amarillo the following morning. This is 12 hours later, generally the closest thing we have to a downstream sounding. And if we overlay those two, the lapse rates here in the mid-levels look pretty similar. Basically what you see in Amarillo above this very shallow moist layer is the old mix layer from the previous day, and out in New Mexico is advecting eastward over the top of the developing moist layer. So we continue to the east. Now here's the Norman sounding that was in proximity to a damaging tornadic supercell. The important thing here is not only do we have the moist layer, but there's the Amarillo sounding overlaid on this. The lapse rates are almost identical. That is the mix layer from 24 hours before out toward New Mexico. So what we're doing is this case illustrates differential advection, and I'll come back to this again at the end of the presentation, where we've got lapse rates coming from one source region in the mid-troposphere, and we have moisture coming from a different source region, which we've already talked about in the moisture cases from the Gulf of Mexico basin. Okay, so we need to look at the climatology. This is something I don't think a lot of people have thought about a whole lot, but it is important, and I refer anyone interested back to the series of papers by Lenici and Warner back in the early 90s, and that does date me, of course, but it's probably the seminal work on the elevated mix layer. The question is, what's normal out there? And it varies seasonally. And again, I refer you specifically to their figure 6, which I will show a reproduction of that here. Okay, so if we jump to the month of April, this is what they found, the typical values from the sounding. I highlight these in centigrade, 36 to 40 C, and I'm gonna illustrate this on the SKU-T. This is the value of the potential temperature of the dry adiabat. So what's typical of how warm does it get in April, typically over the high terrain. And then you notice as we move into May, they've jumped up by about 4 degrees centigrade. So the warmth of the elevated mix layer, which is that surface layer out there, has increased. And then you go into June, same trend continues. So the values come up seasonally quite a bit. We go from the 30s C to close to 50 centigrade, which is very warm. Now I'll show you what that looks like on the soundings. Here's Albuquerque. This is the typical April mix layer, so 38 C, which is kind of the midpoint of what you saw for that first plot. So this looks like a typical April mix layer that you would see in Albuquerque. Now you notice it's early May, so this is actually on the cool side for what you might expect into May, which had some ramifications in the particular May 3rd event. And so we extend that down, and that just gives you an idea. What's the question here is, when we're thinking differential advection, what's going on down below that? And then when you see the 38C that I'm talking about, it's the potential temperature. It's just we condense the moisture out, and then we take this down dry adiabatically to 1,000 millibars. So the 38C, that's where this comes from. Even though you don't see it on the profile, that's just how you calculate potential temperature. So that dry adiabatic lapse rate, those are values of potential temperature, is another way to look at it. Okay, so here's a Norman sounding from another big tornado day. This was May 19th of 2013. There was a violent tornado by Shawnee. This was the day before the damaging Moore tornado on May 20th. If we look at this, this was the, we look at the lapse rates. This is early April. Now we're looking at a mid to late May case, but if we overlay the typical upstream lapse rates from New Mexico in May, it looks a lot like the mixed layer that you see in this Norman sounding. If we were to continue to early June, you can see the typical elevated mixed layer warms even more. So the point here is it's important to look upstream to figure out how warm is our elevated mixed layer, because that says something about the lapse rates, but also the strength of the cap, which is down here at the base of the elevated mixed layer. Okay, so what should you look for? You know, if you see warmer than normal temperatures across the Rockies, you can actually get a very warm elevated mixed layer, and that might suggest that downstream over the plains it's going to be capped. So record high temperatures over the plateau, not necessarily what you want to see by season. Cooler than normal temperatures could suggest that the mixed layer is not as deep. Of course, you can look at the soundings, but again, it depends on the details. Remember, this will show the case here going back. It develops over several days, and again, we'll just throw some more lapse rate things, and I'm going to come back to that Norman sounding where cooler elevated mixed layer for the season actually can give you bigger buoyancy if you've got seasonably high moisture values beneath that. And again, the only way you're going to figure this out is you have to look at the source regions. You have to start thinking about lapse rates and moisture as what are the source regions for the low-level moisture, what's the source region for the mid-level lapse rates. Okay, well, we'll jump north in the plains. This is the Denver sounding. This is another case, I guess, in early September. Deep mixed layer, nearly 500 millibars from the surface. Here's the sounding downstream at North Platte. And if you just step through these, you notice it looks an awful lot like the same layer. It's just down below that. As you move eastward, the air's coming from somewhere else, and it's a trajectory with upstream moisture source. So we create a lot of buoyancy. If you go back, Denver, there's a little bit of buoyancy potentially for high base convection. As we bring richer moisture beneath that further east, we create much larger cape. And it's not unique to just that one case. You can find this all the time. Here's Rapid City in western South Dakota. We look at the sounding at Aberdeen, and again, further east, almost identical lapse rate layer. So this is just the air from the afternoon before over the high plains has now been transferred to the east above a moist layer. And in this case, the elevated mixed layer is extremely warm at its base, very strong convective inhibition. So differential advection is what we're really getting at for severe storms. We don't want just steep lapse rates and dry profiles. We want steep lapse rates atop a moist layer. So we get the steep lapse rates from the high terrain to the west. The moist layer would be some combination of either the air mass modification or return flow cycle from the Gulf of Mexico. That's most relevant early to mid-spring southern plains, or it could be evapotranspiration aided as we get later into the warm season, more in the central and United plains and Midwest. And that creates the loaded gun profile, which in this case, when I go back to the overlay, the steep lapse rates in the mid-troposphere from the high terrain, the rich moist layer from the Gulf Basin beneath that, you create large buoyancy. And when we talk about the vertical shear, this exact same scenario with differential advection also infers that there's a strongly sheared profile in the winds, because we're bringing in air from the southwest in the mid-levels and then the south and southeast in the low-levels. That, by definition, is a vertical shear. So this is related to lee cyclogenesis, which we will also talk about in another one of the presentations. So again, you just look at that mixed layer, and again, the last thing you'd consider the strength of the cap. We do need thunderstorms to worry about severe weather. It's just how warm is the base of the EML, and what's the depth and quality of low-level moisture, and then what does the surface heating and mixing look like, both in the moist layer to the east and within the mixed layer to the west.